Hey guys, it's February 11th, 2017, and it's episode 62 of 4Play Anime Cast. Welcome all. I'm your host, Spire, and as usual, we have our co-hosts here.
Oh. Host. Hi.
What's up? Nothing much? Quiet? What's going on?
You want me to talk about the new cards that are coming out?
For Yu-Gi-Oh?
Yeah, because there's this 20th anniversary pack is coming out. It's got some sweet cards in it.
All right. Well, maybe you can cover that later, Nier.
Hey.
What? How are you feeling today?
I'm sick.
Flu, fever. What's going on?
I got tummy trouble.
Okay, that's so fun.
Drink cranberry juice.
Dark.
So these new Beyblades are coming out, right?
Holy shit,
dude.
We're done. This fucking story over.
Did you see the new ones that they like explode when they
lose? This is so old. They've done that before though.
What was the show?
Pop off? They've totally had those before.
Yeah, they've had those before. What was the show where there were the mech things and they shot the marbles out of their chest?
Oh fuck. I had those.
It's not Bomberman, right?
No. The Bomberman? No.
I know what you're talking about, but I don't know what it is.
Cause we had those were like hotter than Beyblades when I was in school. Cause Beyblades were fucking banned. Cause some kid cut his finger or something.
Marble shot bots.
Yeah.
There you go. Okay.
Those are cool.
I think that was the first result I got.
Wow, you cheater.
Maybe not, I don't know. I googled it, but I fucking don't know if this is actually the right one.
You know what I'm talking about though, right?
Yeah.
They had like add-ons where they had like sights and shit and like barrels. Stupid.
Oh, it's like Battle Beat. It's one. Oh, okay. It was just one of the Beat-em-on series.
Okay. No, I get that.
Yeah, I know. The thing that I looked up was like some random weird ass ripoff bullshit.
Yeah,
like,
that's Beat-em-on. That's yeah
Beat-em-on. I remember that. Okay.
Fucking goddamn.
Every time I hear Beyblades now, I keep thinking of that one video I watched recently where there's like. They go, it's like the Japanese show, and they go to this, like, guy's house who's like, and he like, opens the door, and he's clearly like 40, 50 years old. Like, he's done with, like, most of his life. But it's like, with like at least a significant portion. And then, like he starts, like, they bring up the subject of Beyblades, and he, like, starts, like, going on this entire tirade about how he's, like, the Beyblade master, like, like when he unleashes his power, blah, 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 and he brings out this entire, like, green pad, and he starts showing off his Beyblades, and people are just like, what's going on? Like, it's very impressive, but what's going on?
Man, he has years of experience.
That is true. Literally decades of experience here. But, yeah. Anyways. As for me, I've been pretty quiet. I think these past 2 weeks have been my sort of like quote unquote catching up to anime thing. I mean, like I had like a steady stream of like watching new stuff before, but like this week I definitely watched like a couple more series. I'll probably be finishing off the rest of the series I haven't watched, which is stuff like Idol Jihen, the Idol Incidents thing, Bang Dreams, and like one or two more I didn't watch. One Room, I think, or whatever that. Freaking series is that's like you're like in this room with a girl. Wow, experiences. It's like
I wanted to watch that. I wanted to know if that was first person or not.
But that's I don't think it is. I feel like I clicked on it to skim it, and I don't think there was anything like.
Yeah, it's probably something like ordinary for-ish, like pretty standard shit.
If it's not first person, then I don't care.
Is it directed by Tommy Wiseau?
Oh shit!
Not like this.
If only, dude.
Hey, man,
Tommy Wiseau anime would be amazing.
I want that.
Yeah, but yeah. As for a series I've been watching, I've been watching some Full Metal Academia. I finally got to it. I watched.
Yeah, 10 out of 10, right?
Literally the most artistic anime has ever been in my life.
If you disagree with me, you're wrong.
You're trash, yeah.
You like the part where they pulled Daria out of the...
I don't know what we're talking about here anymore.
Daria out of the... ACCA, right? The 13th, like, investigation, whatever the fuck.
You mean ACCA?
ACCA? Oh, yeah. ACCA, excuse
that,
me.
That weirded me out.
ACCA. The worst part is, like, it's still in capitalized letters, so they're still saying, like, ACCA everywhere. Yeah. But, yeah, anyways. I'm watching a little bit of Oni. I watched a tiny bit of Onihe, and as I said, I'll probably be getting on some other series in the future. But we will be talking about some of those more sort of anticipated series, because a lot of people in, directed by the same guy who did Sleeping with Hinaka. Oh, God, let's not go back to that OV again. But yeah, a lot of people did ask for, you know, a little bit more elaboration on stuff like Little Witch Academia, Onihe, stuff like that, a little bit more on ACCA. So we're probably going to be covering those series today. How about you, Nier?
I've been playing For Honor.
Ah, yes.
Very anime, I know.
Very anime.
Just choose the samurais, and that's it.
Yeah. The spear girl is pretty OP, I'm not gonna lie. But yeah, other than that, I have watched ACCA or ACCA.
Yeah.
I don't know what the fuck I'm supposed to call that anymore.
It's called ACCA, I guess. Doesn't really matter, I think.
Yeah. I kinda stopped watching Little Witch Academia, but I think I've watched enough my opinion.
Yeah, as you said during our discussion, we were just like, how much do you really need to catch up on Little Witch Academia in order to understand?
All of it.
Yeah, I think I've watched enough to notice the trend of what Little Witch Academia is kind of doing with itself, episode to episode, so I'll talk about that later. But yeah, I've gone up to episode 3 or 4,
okay.
ACCA. I like it. The music's great. I really like the soundtrack, especially the opening. The opening feels very Persona.
Yeah, it's very like it's like one of those Fujoshi kind of fantasy stuff, but it's not too over the top or like.
Yeah, I like it.
We'll probably talk more about that. Just a bit. But yeah, anything else?
No. Really? FF14. About it.
FF14, near?
FF14 is something you shouldn't get into.
Never get into. Dark.
Is it like PSO2?
We're not going to talk about it.
It's so much like it that they got the crossover.
It's an actual good game, so no. Sorry.
Alright, Dark.
And what have I done with myself?
Yes.
I started and beat Neo in like two or three days.
Wow,
and,
what's Neo?
It's a game. It's pretty anime, actually.
Those trailers are pretty crazy.
Yeah. It's pretty good. It takes a while. Like I said, I beat it in 2 days, but really that translates to not doing many side missions and spending 40 hours. I really didn't. I actually have only slept 2 hours in the past 2 days.
Wow, me too. Also, what's your build?
What's my what?
What's your build?
In Neo, I'm.
What are you maining?
Like quality of life right now. I wanna switch to be swords. The way magic works in that game is really cool. It's like a whole. It's super neat just because of like the whole fact that they twist history, sort of, and stuff like that, like real events and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Like, most of the people in it are real. I think with the exception of the protagonist is based on someone rather than, like, an actual person like Edward Kelly and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's, Japanese people have done this sort of, like, period fantasy kind of thing for as long as, like, most of these writers have been born from their mother's wombs, like, so they're no strangers to making all that pretty seamless.
What if I took the Sengoku period and did something different? Whoa.
What if Nobunaga was
That's never been
a girl?
Here. Don't be crazy.
Nobunaga
was a cook.
Is the itch of playing the last samurai, the video game.
Yeah.
You're a white man in Japan, in like the 1600s.
Yeah.
Okay. Great wall, man.
Anyways, I guess you've also, before we get into talking about the next series, or I guess we should just get started talking about the next series solely. You have watched Little Witch Academia, right? I think.
Yeah.
Okay. Wait, how much of it have you?
I'm all caught up on it.
Okay. Did you watch up to episode 4, or did you just go all the way to like that episode 5? Because like Eraser, I think, has only released episode 4 the last time I checked.
Yeah.
But,
I think I saw episode 5. I saw I saw the one that came out last week, so.
Episode 4 is Lotte's episode.
Yeah, I've been watching it with reference. The Arashi subs or whatever, and those are like... fucking terrible. So
yeah.
Stay away from them if you can. Like
I've been using Eraser.
Yeah.
Legitimately, yeah. Like it's really not worth it. I mean, I can tolerate it because I've put up with some bullshit before, but like I really wouldn't recommend it.
Yeah.
It's... called again, like the text like setting or whatever.
Was that font?
Called again? No, type not
setting?
The font.
Type
yeah, the typesetting is fucking horrendous for Arashi.
Yeah, you've shown
me
where it's like three lines of single words.
Yep.
I mean, I think I've heard Arashi from like before like 2012, 2013 era, and they weren't good back then either, so I wouldn't expect them to hugely improve now.
Yeah, they sure should have an improve then, because it's fucking like complete garbage.
Okay. But before we get fully into our review again, our first series is probably going to be Little Witch Academia, and Little Witch Academia is a series being mainly main production is being done by Trigger. I don't think I really need to go over what Trigger did, right?
Who's Trigger?
What have they done? I hear they're famous for Kiznaiver.
Wow, they don't sound very good.
That it's like the ride was good, and then suddenly you just drove it over a cliff with that comment. It's like, well, nobody wants to watch Trigger now. Anyways.
I hear they're calling Little Witch the Kiznaiver.
The Kiznaiver of anime. Of fantasy. But anyways, Trigger Studios, and I believe the director is Yoshinari, who also helped direct... main stuff did was, like, Gurren Lagann, like... school, there was like a school life, like OVA or whatever, right? Like alternate universe kind of shit. That was the only thing that he really did like full direction for.
Little Witch Academia is about school life.
Yeah, that is true. And for everything else, he's kind of mainly worked on key animation, and he's been essentially like chief animator for most of these before he got into Little Witch Academia, which is his first full series direction.
Honest, I don't think Trigger actually has directors.
they're
all animators.
Yeah, they just have like talus floating around the building. It's like, you come over here and like draw me a frame.
Yeah,
they're a hive mind that just takes turns writing different names down.
And the screenplay / series composition is being done by Michiru Shimada, who has done a couple of like older sort of series. Did Jewel Pet Twinkle. He did all the script writing, I believe, for Little Busters, all series and the OVAs and stuff like that.
Wow, Little Busters, wasn't that great?
Can we not talk about this?
Pretty good.
And then, yeah, that's Shigochara, yeah. Shigokara is the only other series of note that she's done series composition for. So, not exactly the most notable of names, but still a very fancy series. The OVA original received pretty decent applause before, and now it's a full series. So I guess you did give your sort of introductory introductory review a while back, right? So yeah. I'll kind of take it on first. So, the whole series, the main girl, voiced by Megumi Han, also voices like Ram and Guilty Gear and stuff like that. Very active, precocious girl who was inspired by a witch, who was inspired by sort of like an idol witch during her childhood. Now she wants to be a witch. She makes friends at a witch academy and does crazy adventures and stuff, right? And then all these crazy things happen. It's relatively episodic. There are slight growing character developments, but on the whole, it is just like, oh, in this episode, you know, some crazy thing A happens. And this episode, some crazy A thing B happens. Something like that. Other than that, it's very, like, you know, it's mainly focused on the art, as Nier said previously. It's like, there's flashy things happening. They're just, you know, there's this, like, race scene, or there's this, like, chase scene, or there's this, like, explosion that's happening. Like, just watch it, and it's very sort of, like, artsy, I guess, in a sense. That it is linear in that, like, you, like, the way the things develop, like, from foreshadowing to, you know, problem creation to climax to sort of like how the conclusion ends up and how the conclusion affects the development is relatively linear, I think, right?
Yeah, it's very predictable. Like once it introduces the obvious issue of the episode, it's pretty easy to be like, well, I know where this is going.
Yeah, and even how the characters will respond to it.
Yes, yeah.
Exactly.
Like I said last time, I feel like pretty much every episode is essentially kind of like how the OVA was structured, in which, well, the OVA was structured kind of like a, I guess, sort of like a Disney thing where
you have this
setup, right? Mm-hmm. And it's pretty much all used to get to from point A, the starting point where you have these characters and they're doing stuff. Point B, where these characters do something and it creates a visual spectacle, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it feels to me that so far every episode is based on this like idea where you start with your characters, they do some stuff, you introduce something that's going to start a quote-unquote problem, and then the characters immediately solve it, and it creates a visually stunning spectacle.
Right, exactly.
I think my favorite episode so far was probably the racing episode, but like, that whole thing kind of, to me, it felt like they were taking, it feels like they're kind of running the motions of the OVA, and they're extending them, you know? So instead of how in the OVA you had a 3-minute scene where Akko couldn't ride a broom, and she falls off, and she makes a joke, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now you have an entire episode
of
a racing episode, where she finds this super special broom and she's not really flying it, but you know, it's it's wacky and crazy, and you know, it's super entertaining. Like,
do they play Quidditch or some sort of witchy sport?
Yeah, now that you mention that, and some of the chatters are mentioning too, it is pretty like Harry Potter in that sense, like where, you know, they'll try to put in like a decent amount of details to like how the academy actually runs, like what they actually learn in the academy, instead of just being like, they're doing magic. Like,
yeah, they do like to remind you that, like, they are actually in a school.
Yeah.
You know, they are actually supposed to be learning things.
Yeah, they don't just
they are students. You know, they're not just fucking magic kids in a magic place doing magic shit.
It's not like a fucking WV kids. Like, it's not like a 4Kids show kind of thing, right? But yeah, I do agree that it's like the way it kind of ends up, it is essentially just like an extension of the jokes. I also think that that sort of thing still ends up working pretty well for this series.
It works for sure. It's charming. It's definitely charming. It's easily the most charming show this season, in my opinion, just because, you know, it's Trigger, it's Little Witch Academia, and, you know, there you go.
Yeah.
But it does get predictable.
Yeah, I just have like two caveats. Like other than like this package overall is very solid. Like it delivers what it wants to deliver, and it delivers in an admirably very like refined way, a relatively refined way. Just two caveats is just that one, I don't like how they're sort of trying to do this thing with the honor student, right? Deanna Cavendish or whatever.
Yeah.
And the rest of the cast, and they're trying to build that up to something that's, I guess, more important. But the issue is, it's like, it's a lot of times it's being too repetitive and too like flat character development wise. And it's a lot of times it's just
Diana's kind of mean, and then Akko does a thing with her, and then she's not mean.
Wait a minute. The more
next episode, she is mean.
I think also the important thing is that like every episode, Diana finds out like, oh, this girl, like what she said about, you know, shiny chariot, like stuff, she might be okay. Like flashy stuff might be okay. Like that's the whole like realization that she's gonna go through, right? Like episode per episode.
Well, spoilers, but. This is both in the OVA and the first episode, but Diana was there in the crowd with Akko in that first shiny chariot
show.
So it's supposed to be Diana
coming back in a sense.
Rediscovering believing the magic in her heart.
Believing the Disney in her heart.
stupid shit like
Do
that.
Do you
right?
believe in magic in the other girl's heart?
But yeah, my point is like the realizations she's having each episode get retconned every episode. Because she goes back to, you know, snotty, uptight, honor student. And then it's like, well, then we're going to have this other issue. And then she's going to, you know,
realize it again.
And then next episode, we'll do the same thing again, you know?
Yeah. There's 25 episodes, I believe that's how it works, right? Or something? I think it's 25.
Is it?
Sure. I think Mal has it listed as... Mal has it listed as 25.
Okay, so it is 25.
They're pretty accurate. Anyways. Damn. Okay.
So, I think it's going to probably come up episodes 18 through like 22 or something like that, and then 23, maybe 23, and then 24, 25 is going to be like round off kind of bullshit, right?
But I kind of hope it starts earlier than that.
Yeah, I mean,
they'll keep having these like flashbacks, and then like the teacher, I think the teacher will have an earlier kind of thing, like they'll focus on the teacher earlier, like before episode 18, and then like episode 18 onwards, they'll really start focusing on Diana and being like,
Bella. Shiny chariot might be worth it after all. Like that's kind of
the
thing, right?
The Trigger fucking heel turn or face turn rather.
Yeah.
Like I'm a good guy now.
But I do hope that I'm not sure whether I want to say hurry it up. That's not exactly what I want them to do. I just want them to make sure that if this is important, like focus on it and make it a little bit better, like in terms of, you know, not being repetitive as you said. A little bit more and a little bit less of an afterthought in terms of like episode by episode development. Like I don't want her just looking at a picture at the very end of the scene and being like, oh man, realization. Like that's not what I want. Okay. I want something a little bit more. Okay.
Wow, she sure is energetic. Cue credits.
Yeah, I know. That's more or less fine. And then the other just quick caveat I had was just I do wish they will kind of, I mean, I'm okay with like the whole like problem thing, but I also do kind of wish that, how shall I say this? I kind of wish that they focus on the school aspects more, because I do find those cool, but it's like, I can see why it's like they have to show off the problem, because it is like the problem, like the episode is based around the problem, right? But I do also
fire. School's boring.
Yeah, that's true. I thought I would just, you know, believe in myself, and then magic would just be here.
Now but, you're thinking like Akko.
But yeah, it's I just wish that a little bit more of those things would appear, like they did in episodes 1 and 2, and hopefully, you know, that'll lead into some sort of, I don't know, like. I always like setting up the world before, you know, doing stuff for the most part. I mean, like, obviously you can do them concurrently, right? But I do like seeing more of the world and then fitting the sort of people into place, right? So I kind of wish I could see a little bit more of that world, because, I mean, Trigger and the script writers also seem to be, you know, welcoming to, you know, showing us more of that world, especially if it's going to be relatively funny and flashy and stuff like that. You know, like how in the episode where they took the classes, right? Where it's like they had like the various scenes of like the main girl, like Akko, just like kind of sleeping through all our classes or being like super confused.
Yeah.
And then like Susie, like the weird girl. Like
her little sidekick. Sprout on her head.
Yeah, yeah, just like grows the little sprout on her head, or is doing like random experiments next to her. Like I find those little things a lot to be part of a significant part of the charm of Little Witch Academia, when it's not about the whole like, oh, solve the problem, see butterflies flying off. Like, that's a good part, but that's not the entire episode. I think, yeah. I would like the other parts of the episode to be a little bit more like that.
I mean, going back to the scene of the classes is another one of my points of the TV series is kind of running through the motions of the OVA, because that, like, pretty much that exact scene was in the OVA with the exact same length, but instead of a sprout on Akko's head, Susie gave Akko a big nose instead. It's like, whoa, really different this time, whoa, you know?
Creativity!
Like, yeah, those scenes are nice, but I kind of want to see something that wasn't in the OVAs.
Yeah, it's like, it's
the
like
show.
They're being creative with their art, but they're not being creative with like what's going on in like the series.
Yeah,
it's kind of unfortunate, but oh well. Also, it's like a actually, before I say this, Dark, did you have anything to say about, you know, like all this?
I mean, just to add to it, like the repetition thing, I'm really hoping that sooner rather than later they kind of stop that.
Yeah.
Like really soon, because it's kind of getting old, where it's like, in the episode with the butterflies, Akko pretty much saves Diana from committing what I'd imagine a huge fucking crime at that point. Because she'd be murdering these 200-year-old butterflies that need to hatch. Or it'd be a huge problem. And by the next episode, she's like, fuck you, Akko. I don't care. You've never done magic before in your life. And it's like, you just saw her do magic, and she saved your ass.
Yeah, exactly.
And you felt bad for taking credit for it. Not bad enough to try and explain the situation, though. Fucking asshole.
Yeah, I just,
but still, like, it was kind of annoying seeing that, because in episode 5 it comes up again, where she's like, shut up, Akko, I can handle this situation, you can't do magic. It's like, yeah, she already has done it in front of you on more than one occasion.
Yeah, the development is, please. Again, as we said, it's so, I don't know whether that's so much the fault, is it just, I don't know whether it's the script writer's thinking is just like, oh, well, it's 25 episodes, we gotta lengthen it out, you know, we gotta stretch it out, that's how it works, right? And as I said, that they'll probably do the significant, like, breakneck pace of development, like, way later down the line, right? Like, episodes 18+. and then, or whether it's just them being stupid, but you know, we'll find out. Also, a quick shout out to Munase Michio, who did voice Susie in the the series. Her voice is really funny. Also, she's like a relative newcomer to like just voicing stuff. All of her stuff, I think, has been the past like year and this year. It's like Flip Flappers, Sakikoso no Sainan, Shores Marken, Senki Zesho Symphogear GX, stuff like that. It's like, I think she's on the route. I mean, if she does like definitely like more roles in the summer or whatever, right? I think she's on a good track to becoming probably one of my contenders for best newcoming voice actor, newcomer. So yeah, I really liked her voice. So I'd say that.
The unfortunate part, I think, is that Susie might be the only thing she actually like voices, because in Flip Flapper, she's just the rabbit, so she's just making noises.
I think she did, her like other sort of more known role is like in, she's also doing like Kamisama Minarai, but that's like a kid's show. But the only other super like relatively known show is like she did some supporting role in Symphogear, but that's whatever. But yeah, haven't seen it. haven't heard.
As Reprock. Like,
yeah. Have that Karki. The last time I really heard something like that was like maybe back in like Dentali no Shoka. It's like Flemburish and a Koshimizuami, but yeah. Anyways, that's all for Little Witch Academia. Hope you enjoyed that review.
Show sucks. And...
yeah, don't watch it.
Too artsy. It's over. And the next series, also pretty interesting note, will be ACCA or ACCA. I believe they do refer to it as ACCA in the series itself. ACCA Jusanku Kansatsuka, or also known as the 13th Territory Inspection Department. So again, the summer is in a world separated into 13 wards or territories, with each ward having an observation division controlled by the organization known as ACCA. Jean is known as the craftiest member of ACCA. So Jean is like the vice commander of that inspection thing, and he's supposed to be the guy that watches over pretty much all the other, like, you know, territories, like departments and stuff like that. He's essentially like oversight, like
he's for corruption. Essentially the coolest guy in the world.
So he's supposed to be, you know, inspecting everything, and that's why everybody's sort of, you know, on tiptoes around him, and there's a lot of intrigue going on that involves him, because whenever anybody's trying to do something weird politically, he's probably going to sniff it out. And he has this mysterious nature of being able to sniff it out. It is more of a detective series, as I mentioned previously when I gave a quick summary of it, than it is a mystery series. Again, the difference is that in mystery series, what I like to call mystery series, people, like, you are sort of shown the mystery, and the audience is like kind of goes along in kind of helping to solve the mystery, or like they are given tools to be solve the mystery by themselves. Whereas the detective series are more just like, oh, well, it's obvious that this happened. Like, the detective kind of solves it, and the audience often has very incomplete information. They are not able to solve the mystery by themselves. So anyways, just a little bit more info about the series. It is being done by Madhouse, mainly. The director is Shingo Natsume. He, other than doing ACCA, he also did direction for One Punch Man, as well as Space Dandy, both seasons. So a lot of the stuff he's done is mainly like action-related series, although he has done key animation for a lot of other stuff, too. The series composition slash script is being headed by Tomohiro Suzuki, who also did the scripts for One Punch Man, and did the screenplay for Saint Seiya. What the fuck? Okay,
whoa.
A little bit of Tiger Bunny, Saint Seiya, Legendary Sanctuary. But yeah, those are the leading roles. And a little thing of note: the main character, Azuki Joki, is Jean Otis, voiced by Shimonohiro. So,
the one and only, the coolest man imaginable.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think I did give Chris, again, I gave a cursory summary of this in previous episodes, so how about you kick it off for us, Nier, since you did watch it recently also, as well?
Yeah, it's pretty good. I kind of pretty much only got into this show because, A, it's Madhouse.
Yeah.
And I,
pretty good reason. Yeah.
I'm kinda like obligated to watch Madhouse shows. at least a couple episodes.
Gunpoint, yeah.
I like Madhouse. Even if they pick up some bad shit like One Punch Man. But I kinda like this show. I think my biggest gripe, honestly, would probably be the fact that the evidence finding doesn't really happen. It kind of just the evidence kind of just materializes.
The evidence finding is nowhere. Like John just sitting at a computer and being like, So these are time sheets.
I found a crime.
I noticed a difference in these time sheets. You're the criminal.
It's like fucking, oh, I lost my lighter. By the way, I'll open my phone and I'll go to this alleyway and I'll find the guy who has my lighter who is trying to set me up for arson. I'm not gonna show what was in my phone, but you know, my phone has the evidence, you know. Yeah, that kind of rubbed me the wrong way.
What if he texts himself from the future?
Yeah. But other than that, I like it a lot. I think the atmosphere, I guess, is pretty cool.
The tone.
The tone. They're kind of setting up this weird, like, I kind of don't want to say the word political, but it does seem kind of like a
intrigue.
Yeah, it does seem kind of like sort of a political intrigue kind of thing, because they keep mentioning this coup d'etat thing. And,
yeah, I kind of want to actually get into that, if you don't mind me. Sorry if I interrupted you.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I just wanted to quickly mention, first of all, the alleyway thing. It kind of, what you said reminds me of me playing like a LucasArts like point and click, where it's like I go into this like random alleyway. Suddenly, I find stuff that advances the story. It's
combine like your phone and the tin
combine
can
the
and
phone
now
and
you
the smoke,
the door.
The cigarette. But that and the political intrigue thing is. The issue is that I think the reason why you're stumbling with your words right now and trying to kind of describe it as political intrigue.
Well, they never really set up any politics in the show.
They set up hints of it, but they don't actually explain / elaborate on it very well.
Yeah, they're like all of a sudden they're like this guy who
happens.
We,
yeah,
they talk about like, oh, there's rumors of the coup d'etat, and then the mysterious
like
white
fine, like foreshadowing. It's like,
yeah,
fine,
the mysterious white haired guy's like, yeah, whatever, get out of my office.
Get out of here.
And then all of a sudden they're like, by the way, this guy we're just introducing, he's gonna be king, and it's like, wait a minute, there's a king, this is a monarchy, like they set it up. They set up they explain the, I guess, political scenario in this really weird, like, pictograph for kids, right? Like, you remember that scene,
Right?
Where they had the bird mascot talking, and they're, like, explaining the backstory.
Like it's like Shades of Hyoka kind of thing.
Yeah, it was really weird. But, they kind of throw this whole, like, you know, there's a coup d'etat, and it's like, okay, sure. By the way, this guy, by the way, the king is stepping down, and this guy who isn't actually related to the king is going to be the new king, because the last king only had daughters, so this new guy's gonna be king. By the way, there's by the way, there's apparently a president, and he's also retiring. It's like, what is actually going on with the politics in this world?
Like, are you just pulling out the cast right now, or are you like elaborating upon the politics?
Yeah,
or,
like the five generals thing, I liked. You know, it was pretty cool. Like, kind of like,
but it like didn't end up going anywhere. It didn't really.
It was. It had. I mean, it hasn't gone anywhere yet. But it was, like, it was isolated to just the like affecting the investigation bureau, which is what Gene is a part of, right?
Yeah.
And now, all of a sudden, we're talking about kings and coup d'etats, and the new king is apparently saying he's gonna shut down ACCA, which is, you know, the whole governing body, only the king should rule over some stupid shit.
And John's probably gonna get caught up in like the whole like gray moral thing. It's like, do you want to save the department that you're involved with, or
And then they have this thing where his buddy is, you know, following
super
him. Super double agent, and you know, Gene doesn't know, and he's reporting to the five generals. But what's
the woman
name?
Knows?
The blue hair girl.
Yeah.
She knows. And it's like there's a lot going on in the first three episodes, and.
Let me cut in. I don't think there's a lot going in the first three episodes. I don't think that's accurate enough to kind of describe how we talk about this. I think what
there's a lot going on in the third episode.
Yeah, in the third episode.
I'll say that because the first two are the first episode is just
that'd be cool.
Yeah. Gene discovers this little thing of corruption in the investigation bureau,
and then he smokes for like 10 minutes.
Yeah. I'm cool. By the way, I smoke. Second episode's kind of him doing, you know, something similar, but it sets up the coup d'etat stuff. Mm-hmm. It does a little bit more with the five generals. And then the third episode, it's like,
suddenly, by the way, the cast explodes to like twice its size.
Yeah. By the way, all this shit's happening, and please pay attention because we're not going to explain this to you again.
Yeah,
like, I hope it doesn't crash into itself and explode, but it's kind of hard not to with political intrigue.
Yeah, yeah, I definitely agree with like the pacing because it's like okay, I'm perfectly fine. Like, just as a caveat, you know, people seem to have this, you know, perception that I might, you know, be biased towards very, like, kind of fuzzy, like, you know, slice of life, school life stuff, which, you know, I do watch a lot, and I do, like, but, like, I'm perfectly fine with watching stuff like this, but, the issue is, it's, like, it's trying to do that, and then it pulls up the political intrigue thing, because it needs, A, because it needs to have a backbone of plot, and because, B, because political intrigue is cool and chill, and they can talk about it without shouting, I guess.
Yeah.
Which they never shout. Cause they're
too cool, dude.
They're too cool to shout. So they're setting up the backbone of the plot. They're bringing in like the characters, which they'll have sort of, I guess, their individual allegiances, but they'll also need to tie it back, their character developments, to sort of the themes that Jean brings up. You know, like with the whole like centering around the cigarette thing, right? It's like, oh, if that's a rarity, or like, you know, I guess it's like some of it will end up in like a discussion of privilege, like how he talked to that like dude who was like near the arson site, where it's like, why do you have that cigarette? Like, obviously it means you're rich, blah blah blah, and like privilege. And then they have the whole like discussion, right?
He gets them for free.
Yeah, all that bullshit. And I think the other character developments will also start sort of slowly centering around that sort of theme. Is my prediction. And it's trying to do that, but not only is that hard to do, but they're already messing up the development pacing. And that's very hard. Like, this isn't even like Little Witch Academia, which has 25 episodes. This is a 12 episode series. A quarter of it, a third of it is already done. So the issue is that, like, it needs to get its ass in gear. Like, it gets fucking rear in gear and, like, go. Because, as you said, like, the Palooka intrigue thing was mentioned, I think, in even in episode one or something. Like, somebody mentioned it.
I think coup d'etat, the coup d'etat thing is hinted at the very end of episode one.
Yeah, like, they mentioned it. Like, as long as they mentioned the word or some bullshit, right? Yeah, or something like
that.
Yeah. It's like, it started, but, like, it didn't have any legs. People were just like, oh, there are some rumors of this thing going on. And then, like, you know, as you said, episode three, suddenly just, like, everything explodes. Like, we have, like, 15 new characters. The characters that usually don't interact too much, other than, you know, being cool and smoking next to each other, start interacting severely. They bring in the plot, you know. They start doing, like, the cross, you know, interactions so that the connections will, you know, all fit into place later. Like, the interpersonal connections that lead into, you know, them being like, oh, I recognize you. That'll probably happen down the line, like, a couple of episodes, right? With, like, the king and, like, the sister probably or something like that, right?
Yeah.
And the prince. So, like, that's happening. And, like, all this meanwhile, I'm still getting the sense that they're not doing it fast enough. And what I mean by that is, like, they talk about this political intrigue, and they have this, like, very bare-bones plot, right? Like, the prince is, like, having a celebration or something like that, right? And the white dude is, like, voiced by Junichi Suabe, is evil. And then everybody's gathered at this party. Like, all the important figureheads are gathered at this party. So I guess it becomes this, like, huge game of spy party, right? It's, like, where you're trying to prevent the sniper or something like that, I guess, sometimes.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe it'll turn out, okay, maybe it won't. The issue is, it's like, that's not enough. Because it's like, the point of the coup d'etat in the context of the story not only needs to be the plot itself, right? Like, what's going to happen, right? It needs to be who's involved in it, why are they involved in it, their tiebacks to this whole, like, theme of, I guess, like, privilege, exclusion, whatever, right? And obviously, they need to kind of flesh out, you know, their consequences, like what's going to happen, how their connections are going to work out. So they have all this other bullshit that they need to explain. And that's not just, you know, how is the coup d'etat going to occur, right? And the fact that they're not doing this is like, and the fact that, you know, all this information is still being spewed out is kind of painful to me. Because it's like, they're kind of stuck in this, well, like,
they're
so much out right now.
Yeah, they're setting up a lot.
But they're not done yet. Yeah, but they're still too slow in a sense.
Yeah, they're setting up a lot, but they haven't actually gone anywhere.
Yeah. Any
yet.
Yeah.
So the issue is, they've set up so much immediately, like,
yeah,
just right out of the gate, right?
Yeah, because they're too cool, like, first two episodes or whatever. Yeah.
We spent too much time being cool. Now we have to set stuff up. But yeah, they set up, like, everything in the plot, like, just bam, within, like, 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And now the issue is, are they gonna do everything that they've set up?
Yeah.
Or are they just going to focus on one of these things, and then everything else takes a back burner? Well,
right.
One thing gets solved, but all these things have been set up, so the audience is left questioning, you know, what about this thing that, you know, they talked about in episode three,
yeah,
that hasn't happened yet? You know, yeah, it's episode six or something, and they haven't even mentioned the fact that the blue-haired girl knows he's a spy. They haven't mentioned the coup d'etat in, like, four episodes, you know? Who knows?
Like, how the white-haired dude is, like, related to it or whatever.
Yeah, they've set up so much that they now have to either do it all at the same time,
right,
or they have to blow through it fast enough that it doesn't seem like the series has forgotten about what it set up.
Yeah, I think, honestly, it'll be a little bit anticlimactic, but I think what they'll probably do is they'll focus on, like, one central plot that the white-haired dude is doing, and then kind of just build from there and like Jean's relationships with that sort of plot or doing whatever. I think that'll be it. That aside, I think the cool part is also a little bit lacking. Like, the tone is, like, there. It's, like, the setup is there, but it's, like, what they actually do. Like, I like the part, like, I like, you know, the drives. I like, you know, seeing the marketplace. I like seeing all that stuff with the music, and that's chill. But those don't get nearly enough time, I think. When Jean, you know, goes for a smoke and he says some deep stuff, usually either he's always, like, it's almost always like the deep stuff always ends up being something like along the lines of, I can't believe that guy's smoking a cigarette. No, that's a luxury good, right? Or like, they've said that like three different times. So it's not actually like something deep. Or like, they don't actually say anything deep. They just talk about, you know, their families or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And it's like...
Yeah, I've noticed that too. There's a lot of scenes where it's just like...
You know, cigarettes are a luxury good, right? Like, that's it.
There's a lot of, there's a lot of stuff where it's like, the sister and I forget what the guy has the mustache, his name is, and they're sitting there eating tea,
yeah,
or eating drinking tea,
yeah.
And
you can and eat if it's frozen.
they don't talk about anything,
yeah,
right? Like it's small talk, and it's like, okay, what was the point of that? And then there's the scene where Jean goes out for burgers in that. When he's visiting that other district,
yeah,
it's like, okay.
The thing is, like,
he's eating burgers.
Those things would be okay if it was like an actual, like, if it was clear that it was like an actual facet of the series. Like as we said, like if that plus the marketplace plus whatever was like a significant part of like Jean's experiences as he inspected the places, like going through them, like, oh, this is this district. These are the people that react to me like this, although I'm the inspection director or whatever. I think I'd be cool with that. But it's not really like that. It's like 30-second clips of like, or like 20-second clips of like, oh, large hamburgers. Oh, blah, 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 them eating toast. Oh, be sure to like take your coat out. It's cold today or something like that, right?
Yeah.
And that's it. And I kind of am disappointed by that, I think.
I mean, I kind of like those small interactions because they add that little bit of, I don't know.
No, I like it. I just wish they focused more of it if they were going to do it. Instead
yeah,
of just
I wish like they meant something, you know.
Yeah.
Because the small details of them, of characters, you know, having small talk with each other is nice.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't, you know, doesn't really add anything besides it being nice. Like,
yeah, and cool.
The guy being like, oh, my kids will be taking that tour next year. It's like, wow, they're that old already? It's like, okay. That's nice. That's a nice tidbit.
Yeah, but like this literally like, has like nothing. Yeah.
Yeah, like well,
it has no emotional significance, it has no plot significance.
Yeah. I didn't need to know that, you know.
Yeah, well you know, sometimes in life you get details that you didn't.
Wow, it really builds character to this guy who the only words he ever utters on screen are about his kids.
But it proves shows that he has a family, that he's a family man.
The thing, again, as you said, it's like, they kind of throw it in as if they're just like, oh yeah, this is part of the cool experience. So we'll just kind of throw in some stuff, you know, like daily life, and then he'll go back to being cool again while he's smoking, and all that bullshit. But I do wish it was a little bit more of a seamless and a little bit more of a thorough experience than just, you know, throwing in stuff, smoking scene, throwing in stuff, smoking scene. Like that's not exactly how I want to do it, although the idea is definitely conveyed to me.
Yeah.
I also, one other thing. Oh, one last thing I just wanted to point out about this series was that, so as you said, Shimonohiro, the eternal Dote voice, the eternal DT voice, is voicing the main character. And I expect, like, every time he says something, I just expect it to start breaking out into his, like, pocket,
yeah,
like, his, like, dumb voice, right? And
yeah.
And also, like there's this one scene where it's like he's like crouching down because of like a girl or whatever, or because of the lady, like the blue haired lady, right? And he's like, oh my god, this girl's so beautiful or whatever, right? And the only thing that's going through my head is like, even when Shimoda Hiro gets a part that is literally described as the coolest guy in town, like he still has a dote line. like this man, like he can't escape.
You know, I do think he does like a really, really good job in this role though.
No, he does.
He does actually pull off like sounding cool, you know.
Yeah. I think he does this sort of like I could care less about this, like whatever, like I'm going through this. I think he does that a little bit pretty decently. I don't know how much effort it takes, but he does it pretty well. I thought like before, like in the years before, that he would, if he did it, he would make for a very cool, like sort of cold villain voice. But yeah. Then the closest he ever got to that was with Lucifer and Hatarako Maosama.
Right, but then yeah.
Lucifer ended up being freaking like one of the biggest like comedy sticks like in the series, and I was just like, like he can't escape. So
but yeah, it is weird hearing him be the quote unquote coolest guy in town, but then you have like his best friend who is voiced by
Suda Kenjiro or something like that?
Yeah, Suda Kenjiro, who's got like this super deep manly voice. It's like, damn, he sounds cool.
Like smoker voice, like yeah.
Yeah, the
raspy voice, yeah.
The dark skinned general guy is voiced by Koji Yusa, I think, who also has a very like deep and like kind of raspy voice, and it's like there's all these side characters with like these really deep, really almost like mysterious sounding voices.
They all have like Fujoshi voices, like,
and then the main character is supposed to be the coolest guy in town.
Yeah,
and he's,
I don't know whether they did it that meant to like troll like your story, but like the light hair voice again, like Junichi Suave, like they have like the prince even is like Miyano Mamoru and stuff like that.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Like. The main character is Shimoda Hiro, like, excuse me?
Yeah, like, all the male characters have, like, deeper, cooler voices.
Like, BL voices, yeah, essentially.
Yeah, yeah. Like, it's really funny. But, yeah, I think he does a good job as Gene.
Yeah, definitely. But, yeah, any last comments about Akka, ACCA?
It's pretty cool.
Would you recommend it? Like, to, I guess, to a general audience, like, what would you point out about it?
I mean,
the premise sounds like it's something that most casual anime watchers would like.
The thing is, it's like, we always talk about, like, you know, people are always like, this is such a unique anime, blah, 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 but it's like, it would be better if they clarified, I guess, right? In a sense.
Yeah, I think to the, I don't really know how to put this to the Attack on Titan watcher, you know.
the mainstream watchers.
I don't think this is necessarily a bad show to watch. To that kind of person, but it's definitely good to point out that the show obviously doesn't have, you know, crazy action. It doesn't have insanely high stakes, at least. Mm-hmm. Right now, who knows, it might later with this coup d'etat shit, but you know, it's not going to be some crazy riveting experience. What it is a pretty neat detective story. A pretty cool, if you will, setting, and some pretty interesting and pretty mysterious characters, you know. If people like a detective series and they're not just out for dumb action like Attack on Titan or One Punch Man, then yeah, I would recommend this. To the person who only likes slice of life, maybe not so much. But you know, to the One Punch Man fan, I'd say give it a go.
Yeah.
How would you compare it to something like Guilty Crown or something?
What?
I don't
Yeah.
know. I'm thinking of something mainstream that's
I
dark
just got triggered real
and
hard
has
right
like
now.
that
Fucking
setting.
completely out of left field, but all right.
Well, I'd say Guilty Crown has some nice music, but
I
I didn't
mean, you're
like it.
comparing it to something like Attack on Titan, and that's not the setting's not kind of right. Not, is it Gu- is it Guilty Crown? No. Yes. What was that one show with the Kanahanazawa speaking English?
Isn't that like half of them?
Psycho Pass. There you go. There you go.
I don't think either of which are anywhere near what Akka is.
I
That
mean,
that's the one I was thinking of.
I think if you're talking about, yeah, if you're talking about Psycho Pass, if somebody liked Psycho Pass, I would say, yeah, watch ACCA because Psycho Pass, again, is a good detective series, although I think it's more in line of like a cop drama, whereas ACCA is more of like a just general drama, you know?
We still don't know how far down the rabbit hole the whole like political drama that they're planning
Yeah,
to go, or how even how good it'll be in a sense. So
that's the
that's
big
the kicker.
that's the big if is whether the political drama either A goes full on political drama
And
or
B if it's good.
B if it's actually done well. When's the last time political drama's been done well?
This election?
I don't remember,
I don't
but
remember, yeah.
This election.
Wow, dude.
Yeah.
That's topical.
There you
But,
go. But yeah, you know, if it's good, it's gonna impress me, but that's like a one in a million chance, to be honest.
yeah. I just, yeah, as you said, I just wish it would be. Again, if it gets its rear end gear, if it packs up all the things nicely, if it, you know, summarizes all the things that it listed that needs to be explained for the coup d'etat, if it respected the theme and it kind of focuses more either on making the intrigue good or making the slice of life aspect plus like Jean like smoking and doing whatever, saying cool stuff, if they focus well on that, I think it'll be one of definitely at least one of the better show this one of the top shows this season. Well, we will have to see if it kind of stumbles or not, I think. But overall I would still recommend it. But yeah, so that was it for Akka again. If you do like if you do did like what you hear heard from here, that's just like the cool sort of series. Like there's not like a lot of shouting, sword wielding or whatever, but there is a lot of sort of like there's a lot of talking heads, but it's not like it's not just like them talking about whatever. It is like a lot of like sort of implications, sort of hinting, whatever, stuff like that. So if you do like that sort of stuff, do check it out.
If there's not a lot of sword wielding, is there some sword wielding?
Do they even have swords?
Some like
The
electricity
prince
powers?
has a sword.
Yeah,
Do they
that's
have
true.
like police batons or like
They have
something?
police swords.
Yeah. Those are called
Do they go to,
sabers.
does Jean go into like another world sometime in another episode?
His cigarette turns into a sword.
Yeah. Meets some real. But anyways. with that, we'll move on to the news. And some weird stuff being propped up in the past 2 weeks. First off, we have the Macross 35th anniversary includes VR concert planetarium projects in 2017. So they, and
VR.
obviously the franchise celebrates 35th anniversary. They are planning on doing some virtual reality stuff, live music concert, theater, planetarium, listed as planetalium, amusement center, projection mapping display, toy shop, and network projects. The announcement video began with images of characters from different Macross anime over the decades. The concert also announced a new television anime for 2018. Yeah,
Shit.
so
What?
is that gonna be subbed by fucking GG too?
How do you have
You can only watch it within the planetarium.
a live music concert
Like Miku style?
virtual reality?
No. Those two are separate.
Oh, okay.
They have something for.
I was gonna say, is the crowd just gonna be sitting there with headsets or what?
It's gonna be like the Hatsune Miku. It's gonna be like the Hatsune Miku concert thing, right? I guess. I don't know. Yeah.
They could do it like the VGAs, where you could be at home watching in VR. It's like I'm really there.
The cringe is really here.
Yeah. So yeah, watch out for that if you are a Macross fan. Although most of, again, I guess most of the attractions are in Japan, right?
Macross is dead. It's all pop music now. Forget the fact that Macross has always had, you know, whatever's popular for the time.
Yeah,
Macross is dead.
You're gonna be listening to Macross music during or Macross OST like in the planetarium or whatever. It's gonna be. Planetarium or like rave or whatever.
Go back to the early 2000s of Macross where they just overlaid Linkin Park. That'd be a hell of a series.
Anyways, next piece of news. The Pokemon Company president, Tsunekazu Ishihara, said in an interview with Nikkei Asia Review that the Pokemon Company and Nintendo are looking into developing a device that will allow the Pokemon Go smartphone game to be played more safely.
It's called a gun.
It's called
Pokemon brand Mace.
To avoid the danger, we also released Pokemon Go Plus, a smartphone-linked wearable device so that Pokemon Go players do not always have to be looking down at their smartphone screens. Together with Nintendo, we are thinking of developing a new device to be played more safe. I don't think that's the... Okay, look, I think the best thing you can do is honestly just have a fucking age and IQ restriction for these kinds of phones.
Or you just play with a buddy, like some guy that watches out for you, or like has you on a leash.
It's like, no, because it's like, I mean, even so like there are groups of people that like, the issue is like, most of these people are like, always, like the incidents that they're getting into are like Darwin Award incidents, right? It's like they have these people
walking
that are
in the parking lot in the middle of the night. Whoa,
Like there are these people like walking into a over a cliff or something, or like walking into like a forest where like robbers are waiting for them, or some stupid shit, like some incredibly dumb shit.
What if you were playing?
What
Pokemon
fucking
Go
year is this? Fire?
Walk into a murder scene.
That like roaming bands of fucking thieves just.
There was news of people like I don't know whether it was like a park or like a forest or whatever, but it was like.
I mean, did you see that dude who got robbed on live
some thieves
Twitch?
Were like waiting in like a certain area where it's like
people do drugs in the woods, and if some guy with a fancy smartphone wanders in there, they're probably gonna get mugged.
Yeah, like they saw that the Pokemon Go spot was like a center where like there was some Pokemon that was.
Yeah, that's another point too. There's fucking people going to Pokemon Go spots and stealing phones.
So they waited there, and then like one or two people like walked in and got mugged like in the area, like that sort of like bullshit, right? Like don't walk into the woods because of Pokemon Go, guys. Like why?
You can't tell me what to do. What if there's grass type Pokemon in there?
See, like I always thought that they should have had like a button to honestly report Pokestops and like gyms and stuff like that.
Yeah, report
if they
like
were
areas.
In, like a fucked up. Yeah, if they were in like a fucked up spot and like if enough people report it, they'll check it out and see exactly where it is. If it's like you know by a fucking.
They should also
house,
have like
get rid of it.
They should also have like an emergency contact or like a life alert button or something like that.
Oh shit! Like a 911
bugged. I can't
like,
get up.
Button
like the
immediately.
Pikachu just runs. Like,
it's like a shortcut. Just hold down on the Pokeball for more than 10 seconds, and there you go. It dials 911 for you.
Yeah.
My Pikachu has fallen and can't get up.
Yeah. Oh my god. But yeah, Pokemon Go, like the device to make it safer. I don't know how much that'll work, but we'll see. Next is a little piece of news. Again, we don't usually do these sets of announcements since it's a little bit big. Going on the heels of what we talked about in terms of Kimi no Nawa or Your Name, and In This Corner of the World or whatever it is.
Yes.
Those films. In This Corner of the World, Shout Factory has licensed In This Corner of the World anime film to be premiered in US and Canada for this summer. So again, if you were
Canada. You were looking up. Thank you.
Yeah, Canada. Usually we just say fuck those guys, but anyways, if you do want to check that out, know that it is coming soon. I personally, again, cannot wait for the English sub release and stuff like that to be out. I've heard that, again, from many reviews, that this film is quite good, so I want to check this out.
This might be one of the movies I go to see in the theaters, because
Why aren't you watching Kimi no Na wa?
Why aren't you watching Dark Side Dimensions there?
The other anime movies that come out in theaters are usually pretty popular, and yeah. They usually attract really loud, really obnoxious people. And if I go to
I can agree with this.
Yeah, like the story fucking Toast told, where the guy's like, "How big of a Yu-Gi-Oh fan are you?"
Are you saying that this corner of the world is as good, might be as good as the Naruto films?
Yeah.
Oh no. Are you trying to say that there's something wrong with your local high school's anime club taking a trip to the movies?
I'm trying to say that shouting in a movie theater means you should have a bullet in your head.
I mean,
I believe that's what happened to the late Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah,
that's so cool.
Man, was he really shouting?
Current events.
Deserved it, to be honest.
Yeah, GG. But yeah, this definitely isn't going to get too much shouting again. The story's about, I believe, World War II. Yeah, people living their lives during World War II, stuff occurring. So, again, if you were anticipating this sort of thing, know that it is coming out probably in the summer.
See, like, you say people won't shout at that, but they find ways.
They find ways. Oh, Jesus. So, next piece of news. Is more, and it's like it's heading to climax. Well, but the more important thing is that the Toliver Trouble, Toliver is essentially the archetypal like harem series, modern harem series right now. I guess modern would be a bit too much because it's been going on for so long now. But
how long has it been going on? It's like 10 years.
No, it was launched in 2010, I believe. I don't know whether Toliver was launched in 2010, but anyways. Oh, no, it was serialized in 2006. Okay. So, yeah, it's been 10 years. Yeah. So, anyways, it's been going on for quite a while, and it represents sort of like as the how far harem series can get you in life if you are a mangaka. But anyways. The magazine also teased that the manga, Toliver Darkness, which is a sequel to Toliver, will get a new quote-unquote secret project. Now,
that's called a spin-off? Like, we're going to be like a Momo spin-off? Or a
Lava spin-off? Or whatever. Yeah, no, I guess. But, like, don't get me wrong, I am the biggest Toliver a fan within at least like 500 miles, if not at least like within at least like 10 states. Okay, like I am the biggest Toliver fan
within at least 5 solar systems.
Yeah, within at least 5 solar systems. But I've never liked this whole like dragging out for more than a year.
Right? How often does he publish chapters? Like once a month?
Like every like 2 months or every month or something.
Wow, what if he comes like Berserk?
Wow, what if Berserk was that fast?
Your wishes could be that fast. But yeah, I really hate like kind of dragging on for more. Like I'm like, you know, it can have a bittersweet ending, it can have a cheesy ending, whatever. But no, it needs to end somewhere down the road. It needs to end. To have this sort of extra project kind of thing, I don't know. But yeah, if you're excited about that, know that it is coming up. The next thing is a little bit more on the meme side. Zero no Tsukaima, or The Familiar of Zero's final novel volume cover, and this is the 22nd and final volume of Noboru Yamaguchi's alternate world fantasy light novel series Zero no Tsukaima, has been previewed, and it will
just now ending.
Yeah, so you know the whole story behind it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just now doing it because it like slowed down and then it like continued and stuff like
that. Holy shit.
Cause they we'll go over this after I kind of do the first thing about it. Anyways, so volume will ship on February 24th. So the reason why I'm bringing this up is that Zero no Tsukaima is like, I want to say, okay, it's like almost meme status. Like there are references to Zero no Tsukaima in other light novels just because of like how big it is, and B, like how the story the context outside of the light novels happened. So what happened was that the author, the novel's original author, Noboru Yamaguchi, passed away on April 4th, 2013, after a 2-year battle with cancer. He had planned to end the series in its 22nd volume. I believe he had 20 volumes, and then he unfortunately died, I believe, before he could finish all of it. I think it was like 2 volumes or something that was left, but I don't remember all of it. But so he did dictate the series from his bed, I believe, how he wanted it to be out, and he entrusted it to the editors. And he did pass away, unfortunately, in 2013. Because of how the novelist wanted it to continue, obviously, because he dictated the plot and the ending, and how the readers, were clamoring, and his family was just like, we got to do it for him. They brought in a ghostwriter, and they brought in the ideas from. When he like dictated the plot to the editors, and they released the 21st novel a couple of years back, and I believe last year, 2016, and now they are planning to release the final one this year. So that's sort of how it goes. But I mean, it's a long journey. I personally like I was a little bit of a fan of this series, like very early on in my way a long time back. But then again, it's not like a great series, but it's like it holds a special, like for anybody who's like watched it when it was like coming out and stuff like that, it should hold like a special place in their hearts in a sense, because it's just because of how cheesy it is, I think, and because of again the story, it's like one of those stories where it's like. It's kind of cool how it all came out, and it is, and now the journey's ending. So for those of you who are fans of the franchise, it is coming out, and it's probably going to get like translated soon or whatever, so check it out if it does get translated. For those of you who are not aware, Zero no Tsukaima is available in, I believe, in Bakatsuki for a complete translation, so you can check it out then. It is a total of 22 volumes. I believe 21 of them have come out currently, and the final one again will come out on February 24th. Okay, so next. Save this. Oh, so Studio Ghibli winning some awards again. Michael Dudok-DeWitt and Studio Ghibli's The Red Turtle received the Best Animated Feature Independent Award at the 44th Annual Annie Awards on Saturday. Production IG's Miss Hokusai, Makoto Shinkai's Your Name, Long Way North, and My Life as a Zucchini were also nominated in the category. Shinkai and DeWitt were both nominated for Outstanding Achievement, directing in an animated feature production for their respective films. The directing award went to Zootopia. Blah blah blah, and also stuff like that. So please do congratulate them for the awards. No anime were nominated for the main Best Animated Feature category, as Zootopia received the award.
Okay. Ew.
Yeah, Zootopia is like super popular in Japan.
Yeah, Yeah, I remember the flood of fucking art in Texas.
Yeah.
And
next piece of news. Crunchyroll has announced its own convention after Media distribution Crunchyroll, service Crunchyroll, announced on Thursday that it is partnering with Left Field Media to launch a new animation anime convention titled Crunchyroll Expo, or CRX, this year. This convention
they
is...
They could have called it Crunchypo. Short, but no. They have to go to
This convention is scheduled for August 25th to 27th at Santa Clara, California, at the Santa Clara Convention Center. Crunchyroll has launched the website for the event. In addition to Crunchyroll, the event will feature other partners and publishers from the anime industry. Although Crunchyroll has not yet announced specific companies, Left Field Media's team working on the Crunchyroll Expo includes Peter Tatara, formerly of the New York Anime Festival and show manager of Anime NYC. So Crunchyroll Director of Events Adam Sheehan commented that the convention's goal was to follow a different model from other anime conventions. He said conventions and trade shows such as BlizzCon, PAX, XSSW, and E3. Sheehan said that regarding the event, you're going to see some things that have not been done before at anime cons.
Those have video game.
What does that mean?
So
what are they going to announce anime?
I mean, I think they're honestly just going to make it more clean, sanitized, and industrialized. Is my honest prediction.
We should go.
When you say sanitize, I don't know if I can agree with it being very sanitary.
What'll happen is like the photo will be of like the convention hall, like with like you know like the bird's eye view, right? And then like the rest of the photos will just be of like the CEOs of like the various like anime like publisher like the press people just like shaking hands and bullshit like that. Yeah. So what I'm thinking is that like it'll be an anime convention, but it's like half or so of like the convention hall and stuff like that will be kind of like
for stockholders.
For the stockholders and for the networker. It's essentially gonna be a big networking event disguised as an anime convention, is my guess. Because like they have the power to do that. And second of all, it's like the biggest thing for them, right? Like there's no point in them really holding like a big anime convention just for the lulz. Like they can, because they already have their own Crunchyroll sections at like every other major anime convention, right?
Yeah, they always have really cringy AMAs.
Yeah, so they have that stuff, so they don't need to do like anime or whatever. So I think this is honestly just going to be, you know, they're going to have the cosplayers in one corner, and then they're going to have, you know, the CEOs, Japanese, you know, media people just coming in and being like, you know, oh, this is how we can do this. This is how we can scale it up, networking stuff, so on and so forth. I think that's going
to
be it.
Sorry, you must be this rich to access this part of the convention.
Yeah. It's like, oh, you wanted to talk to Hideaki Anno? It's like, not today, buddy. I think it's that kind of thing. I mean,
We should go.
Meet Sage Naruto and Mage in a Barrel.
Sage Naruto.
Yes, dude.
They're going to be in the shareholder section.
Shit.
We can see if Mage in a Barrel talks like he types. And he doesn't actually say anything.
I honestly don't believe that anybody talks like he types, but that's just my optimism for humanity.
What about Sage Naruto?
Now that man is a legend. But
what if he's there?
I don't think Crunchyroll is going to be able to pour more money into it, but I don't think they're going to have anything particularly creative. Like anime conventions have honestly reached their peak for creative stuff, and it's like there's really no point. Nobody's going to do like Disney fireworks stuff, right? Like there's no point in doing that. Like anime nerds are going to like wowing at it, but like the other half is going to be sleeping at their hotel or jacking off to hentai OVAs, right? So I don't think like anime conventions are going to go much further just because Crunchyroll is at the helm. So I think that's going to be a disguise, and I think the real meat of the deal is the anime industry stuff, which is still very strong. Like it's it's going to be a very strong networking event because it's A, it's Crunchyroll, and B, there's going to be a lot of money into it, and they're bringing in people that like know other people already, right? Like the anime NYC guy or whatever, right?
Do you think they'll play Dark Side of Dimensions at this convention? Because I'll go.
Yes, Thomas. They will.
We should go.
If they play Dark Side of Dimensions, I'll go.
Yeah, but I kind of want to see what falls out from this, but I'm not really expecting anything out of the ordinary. They're going to be like, there's going to be some unique stuff. I'm just like, dude, it's a networking event, guys. Like, shut the fuck up.
We should go and ask Crunchyroll why their English is so fucking garbage.
Hey, guys, why do you guys hire all the people who never passed their SATs?
It's going to be unique because it's not going to be open to the public.
It's gonna be the first sort of like general area where like everybody's language, like English is everybody's second language. Like that.
Oh god.
Yeah.
Okay. Next on just like the people announcements, a couple of things on people announcement side. Hideaki Anno has announced that he is working on his next project.
Evangelion?
Yes, so Anno commented last July that he felt he could continue work on Evangelion now that he has finished directing Shin Godzilla and apologized for the delay in the fourth and final film.
Fucking sorry.
he'll do Dogeza like on the stage or whatever during the Q&A. Animation director Takeshi Honda mentioned in an interview in November that the Evangelion team was at work on the new film. Anno has also mentioned that he would like to do a sequel to Shin Godzilla. In before he delayed.
Oh god! Please no.
Shin Kai Godzilla or whatever.
Please just let me off this ride.
So, whoever's excited for Anno's announcement of a new delay for the Evangelion.
Oh no!
The other news is that. Also on the news, there we go. What's it? Sorry, Hikaru Utada announced on her official website on Thursday that she is changing her labels from Universal Music Japan to Sony Music Japan's Epic Records Japan label after a contract with Universal Music expires. She plans to release a new work this year, Phantom. Her first full album in 8 years ranked at number 6 on the US iTunes album chart in September.
And I love Hikaru Utada. She's great.
So whoever's watching up for her, that's just like what she's up to. And the final thing is, before we go into the full people news, it's just a little bit of a funny thing along the lines of what we talked about with the Macross news, the virtual reality bullshit and the planetarium stuff. Kankore Anime's Anime Films app promotes 4DX/MX4D screenings. For those of you who do not know, 4DX is 4D effects, I guess, DX. So with the 4DX or MX4D system, certain theaters have motion seats that move in sync with certain action sequences on screen. Similarly, effects such as sense, wind,
people
and
mist. Oh,
boy. Isn't this just like the Girls in Panzer thing?
Yes. As I have mentioned like many, many times on this podcast, I have experienced a 4D theater before with like the Spider-Man 3 movie, I believe it was. And, it's not a
flaw, you poor soul.
I watched Shrek in 4D.
Dude, that's the that's like a Disney, like Universal Studios or whatever.
Yeah.
But it's not a pleasant experience, especially when you get like water sprayed in your face, like during the movie.
Well, this is about boats, so you're definitely gonna have water sprayed in your face.
Salt water right in your eyes.
Have like extra like sprays just because of the movie, and you're just gonna be like, why is there so much water on these seats? And then you find out.
Fire hydrants.
They're gonna give you a raincoat before you get in there.
Up on the side, get ponchos.
Yeah, it's gonna be one of those like hurricane simulators or whatever.
I mean, would you want a Concolor certified poncho? I would.
Yeah.
Not really. No.
The thing is, like,
when's that movie coming out anyway? It's been enough.
I don't know, dude.
The last thing I noticed was that Toki Takahashi was in it, and that's like the last interesting piece of news from it.
But I just, like, this 40 shit needs to stop. It's really, like, it's not even about the fact that, like, some people might have problems with it. It's just, like, super annoying. Like, this, I know this shit's, like, whenever, like, there's going to be, like, a shell, like, hitting the water, and, like, you know, there's going to be, like, explosion or whatever, I know the teacher's just going to, like, walk back. I'm going to be like, god damn this shit. Like, you can't eat, you can't do anything except freeze in your seats during that time. It's super annoying. I don't know why so many
immersion, dude.
Yeah, man. Shit. It's like when you hear Congo speaking English, there's gonna be some guy throwing tea at you.
I hope the programming of like the motion is like misscripted, so that it's like if Fubuki has like a fucking like intimate scene with somebody, and you're like looking into Fubuki's eyes.
Dress.
So suddenly you just get like water sprayed in your face, like in the middle of it. It's like
that goddamn wedding dress.
But that was it. So if you are hyped about Kankure, know that 4D affects Kankure is coming to you in the near future.
4D wedding dress, Fubuki.
Jesus.
Oh, you can feel the boringness.
They just drop a handkerchief in your face as like the wedding dress flares. What the fuck? I can really feel the cloth. But yeah, all the people news, a lot of kind of sad news these past 2 weeks. First is perhaps the biggest one. The founder of Namco, Nakamura Masaya has passed away. Also nicknamed the father of Pac-Man, founded Namco in 1955. He was announced on Monday that Namco founder Masaya Nakamura has passed away on January 22nd at the age of 91. So, so he passed away.
The movie already came out.
Shunji Fujimura, Shunji has passed away at 82. He acted in numerous live action television dramas, films, and appeared on variety shows. He played the character Watari in the live action Death Note. He voiced the character Tonika in the Kurushi Tsuji series, and Parakeke in the Yono Yono Penguin anime film. This one is pretty kind of unfortunate. Matsuno Rina, a member of the idol group Shiritsu Ebisu Chikaku, passed away on Wednesday, February 8th due to an unspecified disease. She was 18. She was in the middle of, I believe, doing a couple of concerts. And then, her official website announced on Tuesday that Matsuno could not appear at a concert that day due to health issues. So she was trying to recuperate. But then, unfortunately, she did go under a relapse, and then she passed away.
Jeez.
Let's see this. Taniguchi Jiro, the manga artist behind Kotoku no Gourmet, A Distant Neighborhood, Summon of the Gods, The Times of Bochan, has passed away on Saturday at the age of 69. And this is more of just like a health issue, like studio news, but the art studio Atelier BWCA has closed due to the declining health issue, declining health of its director Hidetoshi Kanako, and he has since taken a hiatus from work. Atelier BWCA has done background art design and so on for stuff such as Grimgar, Ayura, Psychic School Worlds, Mob Psycho 100, Record of Lotus War, Love Live, Zankyo no Terra, Terra Resonance, My Neighbor Totoro, and Magic of Stella, among many others. So, again, please do wish the director the best of luck in his recovery. Please do wish the family and friends of those who have passed away my condolences. And with that, we are on to the shoutouts and callouts. So, shout outs, call outs. One shout out, one call. Shout out is one thing that you want to talk up. 10 out of 10, you know, 5 stars on Yelp, whatever. One thing, the cereal that you ate this morning, whatever light novel you read, so on. Praise it, praise be. And the call out is the exact opposite. Something that you hated in the past 2 weeks, maybe hated for the entire year, whatever. Whether it's a person, flag, trend, whatever.
You.
And so, we will start with Toast.
What's up? Oh, me?
Yes, shoutouts and callouts.
My shoutout is to PSR2. Pretty neat. Okay. I got a new outfit. And
call.
Yeah. Call. Congrats.
Congratulations.
My call out is to you guys for not watching Dark Side of Dimensions with me.
Apologies.
Fuck you, dude.
Apologies, my friend.
Do you want to watch Dark Side of Dimensions with me?
No.
See, well, yeah, screw you guys. I'm gonna watch it again for the third time.
Okay.
My Yu-Gi-Oh! Is so old, dude.
Yeah.
There are no useless cards in my grandpa's deck.
Grandpa, why'd you put this card in my deck?
This card is useless.
I hope that's the video. I hope we're talking about the right video, but anyways, keep going.
Shoutouts, huh? How about shoutouts to For Honor, because it lets me kill weebs.
Yeah,
shoutouts to For Honor. For Honor is really good. If you haven't played the open beta, you should, because it's a good game. Even if beta still has some connectivity issues. Call it. You know what? You have it on the news, so I'm gonna call this out. The bomber girl thing.
Yeah, I wanted to bring it up, but I ended up skipping over. Yeah.
Yeah, you glanced over it. Konami announced a new arcade game, Bomber Girl, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like Bomberman.
Except it's a girl.
Surprise. Except there's anime girls. Nice. And when this was announced,
like Bomberman or whatever.
Huh?
It's not just like a female Bomberman, like they're legit like.
No, they're like new characters.
Like a cat.
Yeah.
It's like Senator Pogger shit almost.
Yeah. Yeah. And the game looks fun, right? It looks pretty cool. Kind of a shame it's an arcade game. But when this announcement came out, there were a lot of people who were like, wow, really, Konami? You're gonna wreck Bomberman now? And I'm sitting here like
wreck.
I'm sitting here like,
yeah, sully the name of Bomberman.
They're making a new Bomberman. B, yeah. It's an arcade game, so you're not even ever gonna fucking see it. C, there is no fucking way anybody who's shouting outrage at this gave a single shit about Bomberman in the past 10 years.
Also, what do you mean by ruining Bomberman? That doesn't even make sense. That's like saying like you ruined Tetris. Like that doesn't like how do you ruin Tetris?
Whoa, dude, I held Bomberman so close to my heart. You know? I wasn't super outraged about that really shitty 360 game that turned Bomberman into an edgy robot and it was really bad. But you know, you turn Bomberman into girls as an arcade game? Really? Konami? I don't like Konami. By the way, did you know Konami's a bad company? This is just another reason for me to shit on Konami. I don't actually care about the fucking game.
It's like people
fuck
are
people, dude.
People are just kind of reacting to it becoming quote unquote more anime stuff. Like I actually like I'm gonna be honest. Like people might you know shit on me or like you know think I'm just bullshitting, but it's like I kind of really like the Bomberman games mainly because I played this Korean version of it from like Nixon. Called Crazy Arcade BMB, and I really, really liked it because it was all crazy, and they had like weird maps and stuff like that, and like I had a lot of fun with it. But it's like, it's Bomberman. Like, dude. Like, yeah, like you're
Bomberman?
Yeah, Bomberman X-Zero?
Like, I'm not, yeah, that's I'm not, like, the one I'm like, I, like, whenever I was, like, playing, like, those types of games, like, I was never looking at the character being like, is this a girl? Or whatever, like, I was just playing the game. Like, at the, like, when you're playing the game, nobody gives a single flying fuck about, like, whether it's a girl or whatever, especially since you're on, like, a bird's eye view. So it's like, I don't really understand.
It's just people being like, wow, Konami's making something? I better shit on it. Like, do you want them to make video games or not?
Yeah.
Like, I at least get people being mad about Metal Gear Survive because, like, it's them essentially just reusing assets from MGS5, but making, I mean, obviously it is a cash grab. Sure, it's like, yeah, it's a fucking survival zombie game, right?
Yeah.
But but they're mad because, like, they're still mad about Metal Gear Solid 5. Like, they don't care what Metal Gear Survive is, whether it's good or not, whether it's bad, whether it's an obvious cash grab or not. Like, to me, fuck, Metal Gear Survive looks really fun, right?
I know it's better than fucking 5 because
it's
just all 5's like gameplay and doesn't seem to be any story, which is the worst part of 5.
Yeah, like, there's fucking crafting, there's you have limb damage like in MGS3. Like, to me Metal Gear Survive looks like it has features in it that were supposed to be in Metal Gear Solid 5. But because there's no Kojima and it's a zombie game or whatever, people are all upset about it. Like, because Konami, you know?
Yeah.
And I feel like this Bomber Girl thing is an even pettier excuse to just be mad at Konami.
Yeah. I mean, if it's bad, like be mad at them. But it's like, if it's not, it's like, whatever.
Even if it's bad, though, to say how dare they sully the name of Bomberman, it's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Who cares about, like, Bomberman?
When the fuck has Bomberman been relevant?
To pretend you've cared about Bomberman for the past 10 years is absolutely ridiculous.
I've probably played Bomberman-style games more recently than, like, any of the people actually complaining about.
The last Bomberman game I played was Bomberman Generations. That was an action game on GameCube.
The last Bomberman I played was the fucking re-release or whatever they had on Xbox Arcade.
It's not even that. Like, it's the fact that people are like, man, they ruined Bomberman. And it's like, if they made a new fucking Bomberman that wasn't quote-unquote ruined, like, it'd just be the same game again. It'd be even worse than, like, the new Super Mario Bros. Games, where it's just fucking Mario again. Like, who cares anymore?
Again, it's like what I said.
No, I mean, like, that's an adventure game. I'm talking, like, the side-scroller one. Like, the new Super Mario Bros. It was called.
Oh, man,
for the DS.
What?
And it's just fucking Mario Bros. Again. Like, who cares?
No. What I want to say is, like, again, it'll be, like, wrecking Tetris. Like, it doesn't even make sense. Like, what constitutes wrecking Tetris? Like,
yo, shout outs to Puyo Puyo Tetris finally getting localized, though.
Okay. So that was your shout outs and call outs. I guess I'll do mine before Dark's. My shout out is actually, so I'm still mainly reading light novels and web novels, but I am starting to sort of, I guess, relapse in a sense back to manga stuff, starting with like some whatever, like Guilty Pleasures a lot of times. So I think some of you might be familiar with this title, but my shout out is The Kiss Sis.
What
the fuck is wrong with you, man?
Wait, what the fuck is happening right now? Hold on now. we gotta pause the stream here. Something's wrong.
Please hear me out.
No.
So what happened is couple, I think it was.
What happened was I turned into a massive faggot.
Nice.
A couple of months ago, the manga like celebrated its like 100th chapter or whatever. So to celebrate, they had this chapter where they all came together and they like did this like weird thing where they were just like, to celebrate 100 chapters, we need to show 100 scenes of us like kissing the MC or whatever it is. So the artist literally took his time to draw like at least like 50 different scenes, like 50 different like sketches of like them and like stuff, which is like pretty impressive. Like, let's be real here. And then they start like doing like this very weird, like, obviously because it's like they talk about the 100th chapter and everything, they're breaking the fourth wall, right? So then one of the girls like does like the usual like ichaicha, like flirty thing, and then breaking the fourth wall even harder, they're transported into a school classroom. And then,
but they go to school.
No, they like transport it into it, like it, like the background literally shifts. And then she like kisses him in front of like the other students, because they're all so like, they've also been transported into the classroom because of the manga god's magic or whatever, right? And she kisses him, and then this is the best part. So it's like, so far this is all like sort of like outside of like the plot of the story, right? Because they're just talking about the 100th chapter.
Yeah, is it though?
After she kisses him and it's like, oh, now I'm, you know, going to your high school, that development, like him kissing or she, her kissing him and stuff like that, that leads into the development of the next couple of chapters.
Okay.
So for that sort of thing, you know, like first like sketches and everything, and for the fourth wall comedy, and for the fact that he did the whole like link the fourth wall into the character development, definitely a shout out. Like I can't help myself but give a shout out to that.
Even if stupid. It is.
I mean, you could. You could help yourself. You could have not. You could have not done it, but you did.
But I did. Big old dummy.
And my call out is to, so again, recently I've been kind of, you know, trying to hone my Japanese a little bit more. I've been fucking weird. So I've been translating. I've been translating some series on my own time, just like, you know, going on to Shosetsu. Or
can you go
Wars.
And fucking translate Macross Delta so I can watch it, please?
Please. So I've been going on to these web novel websites and kind of, you know, translating them with the help of the dictionary, of course, since I know like basic like sentence structure and everything, but which like would be fine. But then like, so there are these things where it's like, I mean, English, like Germanic language, is relatively simply structured, right? I would say, in a sense, it's like, I'm not gonna be all like, you know, stuck up and be like, it's the right way to do it, but it's like, it's relatively straightforward. It's like subject, verb, whatever, right? Or like subject, object, verb, or whatever, right?
No.
But the subject comes first and has that priority. Usually it's like reversed in like Japanese, like Korean, like languages and stuff like that, right? Where it's like, there's all this stuff happening, and then the subject kind of comes after it, or something like that. Usually, if it's like the subject is coming first, there's like all this complex stuff going on. And in Asian languages, there's like this additional complexity of like, you can talk about like all these different subjects in one sentence without it being sort of an improper sentence. However, this is where it gets worse. Some fucking authors, because they're like, so fucking like careless and like don't care about, you know, their sentence structure or like grammar or anything, not only create multiple subjects in one sentence and like different clauses and stuff like that, sometimes without commas, whatever, separate them, but also create these like layered subject things where it's like they'll describe an entire thing, like blah blah blah's way of cooking this thing, blah blah blah, they'll have that, and then that'll be an entire thing that's embedded in another sentence, bigger sentence, that describes that in comparison to something else. And then that will be in contrast with something else. I'm just like, oh my god, describe one thing in one sentence, please.
But isn't that like pretty typical of like a lot of Asian in languages, because like
I'm pretty sure in Chinese
used to like not have any sort, and at least in the writing, like it didn't have any punctuation, like it didn't have to have punctuation, it didn't even have to have a subject half the time. Subject was like implied by based on like other shit.
Those are those things, but it's like I'm okay with that, where it's like very implications, where it's like it's short, but it's like it's not clear or whatever. That's okay, and it's like it's kind of, I'm since I'm Korean, it's like I'm okay with if it's like, oh, there's one part of the sentence that's about this subject, and then the second part of the sentence is about this subject. But it's not even like that. It's like you start the sentence, and it's like it's talk about this thing, right? But this thing is described by a second subject that's nested within that sentence. And that second thing has something else that is also nested within the second part of that sentence. And it's like, oh my god, stop doing this like Matryoshka doll thing. Please.
Why can't you just understand the universality of sentences?
The universal altruism of sentences.
Dude, if you can fit that much information in one sentence, though, then you like have to read less.
Yeah, that's true.
It's super convenient.
But yeah, one of my favorite like web novels that is being translated right now, Tsukiga Michibiki Isekai Dochi or something like that, Moonlit Journey in Another World or some bullshit.
Is that the one with the dragon and like the spider lady?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So it is like I really want to read it, but the sentence structure is killing me. So that's my call out for that. Authors with terrible sentence structure. But yeah,
maybe they shouldn't be authors then.
That's my
I tried reading the what's that one where the dude's name was Hajime and he had like
Arifureta.
Yeah, I tried reading the light novel to that and the sentence structure was terrible.
Yeah, I mean for that also the translator himself is not very good. The plot is also pretty terrible, so
it's Let me read you an excerpt. Rabbit-eared Shia Howler's voice echoes in the canyon. Apparently, this rabbit wasn't alone, and her comrades were also in a similar predicament.
She is very
desperate, and though Yue kept increasing the strength of her kicks, there is no sign of letting go, despite the shoe marks on her cheek.
Yeah, that is one sentence, by the way. That's like a great example.
One sentence.
Yeah, that's probably like translated like to the word, to the letter, and that's like the part of the problem I'm describing. It's like they're trying to describe so many things, but it's not even described sequentially. It's like they're describing themselves like cross-linking between each other in the sentence, and that's like so frustrating. But anyways, that's my call out, Dark.
What's up?
Huh?
Mine? Dude, I've been drinking a fucking Captain Morgan and Pepsi this whole damn time.
Jesus Christ.
And it's like Pepsi. 10 ounces of Pepsi, 10 ounces of Captain.
is your shout out to the
captain? I'm almost done. Shout out to the captain. Pepsi. Hey, shout out to Neo. That game was amazing.
I should have given my shout out to Neo. Oh well.
Like, wow. What an amazing game.
It's very Japanese.
I was kind of surprised. Like, I was expecting it to be just like, oh, I'm going to go into this game. It's going to be like a Souls story. I jump in, I fight shit, and that's it. There are an immense amount of cutscenes. It's a massive, like, it's a big story. Everything is like coherent in that sense. Like, there are some things left up to like somewhat interpretation of like behind the scenes stuff, but what happens to like your character and William and stuff and what's happening is very straightforward. Like, it's telling you the story. There's a lot of really like neat stuff with it, a lot of really neat interpretations of the like historical figures and whatnot.
Shout out to the Japanese voice actors for
trying
to speak English.
That was actually one thing I wanted to bring up. The voice cast is amazing. Like, the fact that it's like you get one voice cast, that's it. Like, these characters are Japanese, and when they're Japanese, they're speaking Japanese. The ones that speak English speak English.
Yeah,
and that's it. That's just how it works. And then also shout out to the William's main spirits actor, voice actress, because she speaks Gaelic. And that was really cool.
Oh, that's Gaelic? Oh.
Yeah, yeah. Cersei speaks Gaelic. Because she's a Gaelic spirit.
Because he's a white guy. I get it.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, just a really, really, really impressive game. One thing that my friend brought up that I really want to look into is the engine that they use for like the face capture and stuff to see if it's the same, and like some of it to see if it's the same as the Yakuza games, because a lot of their faces and expressions look very similar to Yakuza Yakuza's like visuals. So I'm very interested in seeing that. I really hope that they have a cool DLC for it with different characters, because the characters are really cool. And yeah, that's pretty much it for my shout out. Call out. I don't really know. I had a call out prepared earlier and I can't remember what it is anymore. So I guess I'll call out the fact that my room is the fact that my room is fucking 79 degrees right now. And because I had to close the door for the podcast, and it's real goddamn hot. Yeah, so that's my call out.
All right, with that, we are done with episode 62 of 4Play AnimeCast. Again, next time we'll probably be more or less finishing up the majority of the series that we will be watching this season. And we'll soon be moving on to talk about the spring season stuff that's coming up, right? Which is coming up, March, April, I believe. I think the earliest ones are like popping up in March, if I remember correctly, the first week of March or something. But anyways, if you do like what we do, again, we stream this live at twitch.tv/4playanimecast with the number 4 every other week, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Saturdays. Here, and we talk about the latest greatest in anime, light novels, web novels, manga, visual novels, whatever, Japanese media, as well as news. And if you do like what we do, please follow us here as well as on social media, on Facebook and Twitter, where we give updates on when we're streaming, what events we're doing, so on and so forth. We do stream visual novels and other games sometimes, usually Japanese media related, like anime related, stuff like that. We also have our own site at 4playanimecast.moe, where we have various content, interviews, our previous podcasts, blah, 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 all categorized by year, by episode, or / date. So you can check those out there, both on Twitch and YouTube. And I'm working on trying to create MP3 uploads for you guys to listen. And yeah, so follow us there, bookmark us at 4playanimecast.moe. Until next time.
Bye.